I've been brooding over this review for more than a quarter of a year now. I have complicated and quite mixed feelings when it comes to LEGO Harry Potter years 1-4, which I still can't put into words as exactly as I would like. Still, I believe I can give you at least a rough outline of what the game does well and what it doesn't do well, and maybe you guys can help me fill in the missing parts. This game has a somewhat unique structure to it. As is custom with LEGO games, each of the 4 movies which LEGO Harry Potter encompasses consists of 6 levels. However, in order to simulate the life of a student at Hogwarts, there are often, as I would like to call them, classroom levels between the actual missions. In these, you have to put new spells or other skills into practice by repeating tasks like putting screaming mandrakes into pots. That's not super interesting by itself, but there's a basis for it in the movies, and it's a logical way of introducing new features. The game's primary audience are children, after all. In fact, LEGO Harry Potter, in a sense, foreshadowed a bit what Traveler's Tales would later attempt with the Skywalker saga, in the sense that a lot of the game happens outside of the actual levels. Now, what I have a problem with is what takes place between the levels and these classroom sections, because you will have to run around a lot. Basically, you have to follow Nearly Headless Nick and those blue signs in order to reach your destination in the maze that is Hogwarts. But running through different screens on autopilot isn't exactly engaging and hurts the game's pacing, especially in the first half. Exploring the castle is actually very fun, as we'll get to in a minute, but I'm saying this from the perspective of someone who wants to get through the campaign without distractions. I do believe that the first half of the game, meaning the first 2 movies, is also worse when it comes to the level design. There are a couple of missions where you can clearly tell that those just exist to meet the requirement of 6 levels per movie. Take the level where you climb up the Quidditch Stadium as an example. Between the cutscene at the start and the cutscene at the end, nothing happens which actually progresses the story. I think the average quality of the missions in the Prisoner of Azkaban and Goblet of Fire is much higher, which might partly come down to these movies including more big action scenes, although I'm not super sure about that. It's been a while since I've watched them for the last time. In any case, even similar ideas are executed better later on. For example, in the Chamber of Secrets, there's a section where we have to run away from this big spider dude in our cars. It's not terrible by any means, but it's super easy and doesn't really convey any fear. Now contrast this with the dragon chase from the 4th movie, which feels a lot more menacing even due to the camera angle alone, and you can see what I'm talking about. In any case, the game's level design is perhaps its biggest weakness. One of my favorite things about LEGO games is entering a level in freeplay mode and unlocking all of the areas which had previously been inaccessible in story mode. I still remember playing LEGO Star Wars The Complete Saga as a young kid and seeing how much bigger the Tantive IV level can be with the right heroes. Unfortunately, most of the levels in LEGO Harry Potter are relatively linear and short. You can even see that reflected in the number of minikits per level. While other LEGO games typically have 10, this game only has 4 minikits per level in the form of house crests, representing the different houses of Hogwarts. And of course, it goes without saying that these look the same in every level, which also takes a bit of fun away from collecting minikits. There are more things to discover, such as a couple of character starts per level, but even then the number of collectibles is lower than usual. And as I said, it's rare that you will ever find something in the way of a secret room, let alone anything bigger than that. I didn't 100% complete each and every level in freeplay mode, but I've seen enough to at least get a general sense of how the game handles its levels. And just for the sake of comprehensiveness, there are definitely some more open levels, like the first mission in the 4th movie. That one allows you to complete a number of tasks in whichever order you prefer. But levels of this kind are few and far between. Overall, it took me 9 hours to complete the campaign, which is around average, maybe a tad above average for a LEGO game. Well, now I've been really mean to the game for quite some time, so let's focus on its positive aspects. I like the variety of spells in the game and how clearly color-coded they are. There's Wingardium Leviosa. For moving objects, a Dementor killing spell, one for lighting up dark areas, and so on. What I will say about the Dementor spell though is that it has a long animation and a short one. Both one-shot a Dementor, but the longer one leaves you wide open for attacks, and those guys are surprisingly quick. I actually don't know what triggers which animation, so this is something that the game could communicate more clearly. As I have already mentioned, you learn the different spells throughout the story, which creates a nice sense of progress. For example, when I finally unlocked the last spell, which allows you to destroy silver Lego bricks, that felt super satisfying. Some characters also have special abilities. For instance, Harry can use his cloak to become invisible, while Ron can take control of his rat, at least for the first three movies. It goes without saying that these abilities are cleverly incorporated into the numerous puzzles. Aside from casting spells, you can also brew potions whenever you come across a cauldron. These potions will grant you special effects like making your character stronger, which is needed to pull certain levers. And they also display a certain attention to detail as different characters have different animations after consuming a potion. But my favorite part of the game is honestly the exploration of the two hub worlds, Diagon Alley and Hogwarts. Now, I only ever visit Diagon Alley for practical purposes such as unlocking extras, characters, variations of spells and so on. The Gringotts Bank has a couple of bonus levels, but those aren't super interesting and there's not a whole lot in Diagon Alley to explore. With Hogwarts, the story is quite different. Admittedly, LEGO Harry Potter came out before the LEGO games jumped on the open world bandwagon, so it's not like Free Roam will keep you occupied for 10 hours or more, but it's cool enough for some additional fun. Hogwarts is still relatively big and there are lots of areas to explore, from a Quidditch practice field where you can fly on your broom, to the lair of a dragon under a classroom. Some sections even introduce time travel mechanics, which is really cool. But the best thing about all of this is undoubtedly the music. I mean, John Williams acted as the composer for the first couple of movies, and that man is honestly just the goat when it comes to soundtracks. The music really manages to capture that feeling of awe, and certainly overshadows the fact that the first LEGO Harry Potter game isn't particularly good looking anymore, almost a decade and a half after its release in 2010. The game itself ran super smoothly, and I only ever encountered a single bug, which occurred in the aforementioned Quidditch level. Basically, I needed to ride a broomstick to get to a house crest, but the broom always threw me off automatically. That meant I couldn't collect all of the crests, which was obviously a bit annoying. I remember playing this game with my younger brother over a decade ago, and so it goes without saying that I have a lot of nostalgic feelings for LEGO Harry Potter, and I'm sure this will apply to a lot of you guys as well. But I want to be as honest as possible on this channel, and the truth of the matter is that LEGO Harry Potter isn't as fun as I remember it being. The first half feels a bit underwhelming, I'd give that maybe a 6.5 out of 10. The second half and free play are better, I'd give those elements of the game a 7.5, which averages out to a 7. While the game undoubtedly does have cool elements like the different spells or the exploration of Hogwarts, it has also some of the most boring level design out of any LEGO game, and that's ultimately a huge deal for me. Let's see if the game's sequel will resonate with me more.